I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to this edition of Disability Viewpoints, our special edition of the Minnesota State Fair. With me is Jerry Hammer, the Executive Director of the Minnesota State Fair. Welcome to our show, Jerry.
Hey, Mark.
Good to have you.
So nice to have you
nice
here.
Nice to have you. So what has changed for this State Fair? There's been a lot of things going on behind the scenes, and we'll talk about a little bit of history and a little bit of accessibility and different things like that and some Jerry Hammer stories as we go along. But what is different about this State Fair this year?
The biggest change is we're having one.
Yeah.
After 2020, which you know everybody would like to forget at different levels, but there are major seasons during the year that we all celebrate in different ways. But a big one, I think, for everybody in Minnesota is State Fair time, and when we don't do a fair, it kind of throws everything upside down.
Now, it did.
We made it a priority right away, as soon as we canceled, which was in May of 2020, to keep our team intact, to keep our operation intact. We didn't know what the succeeding year, we didn't know what this year would look like, and actually we really didn't know what the fair might look like until about 6 weeks ago, you know, until the very end of May, first part of June, and we didn't really even know if there'd be a fair until a couple weeks into May. So everything's happening in a compressed time frame, but it's so good that we kept our operation all together. Everybody's here, everybody's ready to go. We're doing 8 months of work in two, but we're getting it done. But that also means that you will see some things, maybe you know, we usually don't notice things that aren't there, but there will be some features. The giant sing-along where people share microphones, not a good idea. Yeah. You know, we're emerging from the pandemic here thanks to vaccinations. Get your shots, please.
Right.
But if you haven't, please go do it. That's the only reason we're able to do a fair this year.
Yeah, exactly.
But there's other parts of the fair, like the giant sing-along, won't be happening. We're not 100% sure yet what we're doing with exhibit buildings in terms of traffic flow, you know, that kind of thing. A lot of the restrictions are now gone in Minnesota.
Right.
There's no capacity limits. There's not much of anything. We know that it's highly unlikely that people catch things outside. It's far more difficult anyway, and most of our activities are outdoors, so all of that's good as well. But there will be some modifications we'll need to. Just to make sure we stay on top of it and provide as safe an environment as we can.
Exactly right. Now, there's some new accessibility changes here at the fair, I think, as far as restrooms, that type of thing. And if people want to come out, they can call, but know that most of the disabled access is done on Como Avenue and Hoyt.
For Metro Mobility drop-offs, yes, absolutely. And then there's three parking areas as well for people with disabilities. South of Como, right by the Transit Hub, which is right over our shoulder here at the grandstand, and then also on the north side of the fairgrounds.
Great, and then restroom accessibility, some of that has changed because some of them have been remodeled.
What we had to take last year off from capital work. You know, the idea was to keep our operation together. We lost 97% of our revenue.
Right.
So our typical, we've been spending $10-12 million a year on maintenance and capital improvements, and we always dedicate money towards access and improving restrooms. We weren't able to do any of that work last year because we were out of business. If we had, you'd see a beautiful new restroom by the Creative Activities Building, all accessible. That's one that really needs it the most right now.
Yeah.
We weren't able to do that last year, but there still are more than 20 restrooms on the grounds that are accessible.
Yeah.
All of that info is available on our website, or will be very shortly.
Now, when the disabled come and they order, are there shorter counters so that they can have access to the counter and talk to people, or the counters all the same height? But do you have dedicated counters, I guess, is what I'm looking for?
It depends on the vendors, because some of the newer trailers that they have, if it's a portable operation, they automatically build in.
Right.
They build in features specifically for accessibility.
Mm-hmm.
If it's an older stand and they don't have it, all of our vendors are made aware of what's required. If you don't have a counter, then send somebody out, you know, to take an order.
Right.
And if they don't, you know, we have 300 food vendors and 800 commercial vendors that don't sell food, right. not everybody always gets it. You know, it right. depends on who's right. working that day. So so Absolutely. We know it's a work in progress, and we need to stay on top right. of it. But if anybody has any difficulties with anything, with any part of their experience at the fair, let us know, and right. we'll help.
And there's been some security changes this year, as we've all seen on our local news. But everybody can come here and can feel safe. So that's really not an issue, I don't think.
Yeah, we're buttoning up details right now, but what we need to do, what our obligation to do, is to provide the best public safety program we possibly can. And one element to that is law enforcement. Now, for decades, we operated our own police department. This year, right. we're talking with the Ramsey County Sheriff's Office, and we've been attached at the hip with them anyway, for decades. Our longtime chief of police, almost 40 years, Art Blakey, was a what a wonderful man, what a great human being Art was. Yeah. Art was a Ramsey County sheriff, and a lot of our communication systems, our dispatching service, all of that goes through Ramsey County mm-hmm. anyway. And actually, that's the model that you see when you look at other large events right. around the country. So it's the Ramsey County Sheriff will be providing the law enforcement. And security, part of the security. We also have agreements with other security companies. We're installing metal detectors at all our gates this year. We have a different security company for entertainment and grandstand and stages. And the public safety program also involves emergency medical service, EMTs, Regions Hospital, you know, in case someone needs to be transported. Right. But it's has many layers, the public safety program does. It involves local agencies, regional agencies, and federal law enforcement and safety agencies as well. It's all integrated into a very comprehensive, overarching program.
I know that you've had some great conversations with Commissioner John Harrington, too.
Yeah. And yes. John came up with St. Paul PD and knows the fair very well. And I've talked with him a couple times now, and I know his office has been in communication with the sheriff's office and others, and the Department of Public Safety actually will, they're on board to provide officers this year as well. John gets the fair. He understands. Right. He knows what our obligation is. You know, this last time we held a fair, 2019, we had ticket buyers from all 50 states, plus 33 nations around the world. So the fair's kind of a thing, you know, when you grow up across the street, and you live four blocks away like I do now, it's sort of always there.
Right.
But you realize that the fair is a huge event of huge impact. So John Harrington with Department of Public Safety, Ramsey County Sheriff, the state, the city of St. Paul. You know, we do a lot of work with the St. Paul Police as well for traffic control, especially outside of the grounds. They all understand what the fair is. They all understand the impact, and they're all on board to do the best job they can.
I know it's in your blood. You hear every day. But 2014, let's go back a ways. And you had an interesting thing happen right around State Fair time.
right before the fair, I was asked to do a presentation for the International Festival and Events Association in South Korea. At the Mud Festival in South Korea. Yeah. So that was a 4-day whirlwind trip right before the fair. But you know, you want to help out, and you find in festivals and fairs, there are so many people literally around the world. We're all doing the same things together, and the stronger we can be as a group, the more we can help each other. We're always glad to do that. And in that case, yeah, it was kind of a long flight, but on the other hand, you know, what great experience, and actually I was very honored to be asked to attend on behalf of the state fair, and it just shows you the kind of profile the fair does have around the world.
It also shows you that they're watching the product that we put out, which is very good here at the state.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's kind of a true honor, too. Foods this year, what do you know what's happening as far as new foods?
Oh boy, there's two dozen of them, and they're like usual, they're all over the map. The thing is, you can get normal fair food here, of course. You know, everybody likes corn dogs and pronto pups and corn on the cob and donuts and cheese curds and all the rest.
Yeah.
But you don't have to look too far. You don't have to scratch the surface too deep to see that what we have here is incredibly unusual in the fair and festival world. This is a lot of these food items here, they'd go over really well in a gourmet restaurant someplace. Here they happen to be served in a paper boat.
Do you know what the do you know what the process is for somebody who wants to get in and have a booth or a food vending operation?
At any one time, we have 500 applications for food concession space. It's pretty high profile. Again, you know, the fair has a great reputation for food.
Yeah.
In any one year, we might have an opening for 4 or 5
mm-hmm.
of those 500. So the competition is really stiff.
It's tight, yeah.
And there was a day, you know, I've been here so darn long. I can think back to when people used to do on-the-job training here.
How long have you been here?
I've been here. My first year, I was 15 years old, was 1970.
Wow.
I worked in the greenhouse.
So did you like that everybody right on television? We told you how old he really is.
Yeah, I'm 66.
Good for you.
Pick a number you like. Stick with it.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
But that's it. But it's I've seen some incredible changes at the fair during that time. That's a long time, and I've been privileged to be in this job for this is 25 years now, which is.
Yeah.
Getting a little long of tooth for anybody in anything.
No,
but
keep it up, man.
When I tell you, when it's something like the state fair with the kind of appeal it has for folks, you know, I wish I could remember who, but it was within the last year. She said, you guys, you are the bringers of joy.
Yeah,
That's true. And I, you know, we get involved in all the details. You know, we want to do the best job we can for people. But that really truly is the end result, and we're privileged to be able to do that.
So of all those years, is there one memory that sticks out?
Oh,
or one
man.
Thing that you wish you would have done more of or less or not have done?
You know what I wish I would have done more of is keep notes.
Yeah.
Because all that time, you know, it all kind
of
runs together. But there are, you know, grandstand entertainers. I started as the publicity person, it was called, in 1979. And back then, part of the job was taking grandstand entertainers around to interview at the TV stations. Mm-hmm. And Red Skelton, you got to be a little older to remember Red Skelton.
Yeah.
He was he was huge in films and TV back then. And what a nice man! What a sweet man! If anybody has seen him in any program anywhere, that was the real deal. He was great.
Yeah.
So that was one of my first. Memories in that first job, but I think one thing that will stay with me I remember it like it was yesterday. In 2005, we established a veterans garden on the fairgrounds to honor all military veterans of Minnesota, regardless of when they served. And the date coincided with the end of World War II, and we had 4 World War II vets raise the flag that day. One of them was my dad, who is 4th Infantry. He was a D-Day guy and went all the way through Normandy and France and into Paris and wound up in the Hürtgen Forest. He was in combat pretty much every day for 9 months, which is just insane. But anyway, he was one of the guys. Leo McGough from McGough Construction. He was a navigator in the B-17, and then we also had representation from the Marines in the Army Air Corps do that. They're all gone now. That was 16 years ago.
Yeah.
But I will never forget that day.
Welcome back. And if you have your own van with a lift on it, there are designated lots here that you can pull into, correct?
Yes. Drive right up to the gate, and then there's parking.
Okay.
South of Como, right across from the fairgrounds, and right at the transit hub, right behind us here, and then also on the north end of the fairgrounds.
Great. And if you need a cab, you can get that down by the Uber lot.
Yep, yep. Now Uber and Lyft, yeah, the rideshare lot.
The
used
ride
to be the cab
lot.
Stand, now
yeah.
it's the rideshare
yeah.
lot.
Right.
Yep.
And the other thing is that if you are visiting us from a foreign country and you need an interpreter, or you're disabled, you need an interpreter, we have those too.
We have roving teams of ASL interpreters that are here. They do 6 different performances during the day, different stage shows, or like the log rolling show, DNR building, and those are all listed in the daily schedule.
Right.
But then they're also available if you'd like to visit the fair and need an ASL interpreter. They're available as well. You just got to schedule them a couple weeks ahead of time.
Sounds great. And again, visit the website or call the switchboard at the fair. We still have livestock and a lot of those things that haven't changed. A little bit of machinery we still have. And so come and visit those things. They're all pretty much accessible, and the famous cup of milk and all those things and the butter display. And so those are a lot of the memories that people can build on.
Well, and this still is. The fair's, right from the get-go, it's been the place where you meet the people who feed you. You know, the very early fairs, before Minnesota was even a state, everybody here, they were involved in agriculture one way or another.
Well, that's really how it started out, what it was.
Yeah, exactly. And it's as big a part of the fair as it ever was. It just, we've added all these other features as well. But the people who produce food, the livestock,
and there's some animals being born out here every day. One of the things that's built the viewpoints, Jerry, as far as the designated buses from all the malls that come out to the fair, the express buses, if you were to take a bus and somebody who is disabled, what would you recommend?
And make sure that they are accessible, that particular buses, because they do come from a number of lots. We do also have a dedicated lot, park and ride, free parking, and then free bus service to the fair, close to the fairgrounds.
Right.
Those are the kind of details we're still sorting out. But then Metro Mobility, of course, has drop-offs on both the north and south side of the fairgrounds.
Right. Absolutely. And as far as wheelchair rental or repair, scooter repair or rental, you can get those here, I think.
Yep, Hometown Mobility rents motorized push chairs, strollers, wagons, the whole works. And a few years ago, they started taking reservations, so it wasn't a first come, first serve. Now they have plenty of inventory, but I would still recommend make your reservation ahead of time.
So prior to the fair, how would you do that?
Again, visit the State Fair website, mnstatefair.org, under accessibility. And all the contact information is there.
Now, a family's going to come here with a disabled person and think, oh, well, there's some places we can't go because it's not accessible. That isn't always true, because this area we're in today, doing this very show, is very accessible. And we want people to know that if you're coming, come and enjoy it all. Like we said it before, it's Minnesota's happy place. And there's 12 days of it, so come and enjoy all of it. You might not get through it all in one day, so come on back. And it's very easy to do. We can hear in the background there's people getting ready right now.
Yep.
Right now. And I think they've even had fireworks displays out here. Yep. There were days when they had the racetrack out here, which hasn't been for years, but that's another piece of history.
Yep.
And so there's a lot of memories here that are built. And it's a place for families, and it's a place to have fun, and just be yourselves.
Well, and we work really hard to make it accessible to everyone, but there's always more to do. You know, you never really arrive. We're always finding other places, other things we can do, and how we can improve it. We've been at it now for, 40 years. But you know, what was considered accessible 40 years ago, not so much today.
But then again, we've come a long way.
As far as somebody
who has to drive here and a hotel, are there hotels in the in this vicinity that are really state fair oriented? I mean, and where do you get the books or the coupons for the state fair and those type of things?
I think the hotels in the area, the closer they are to the fair, the more fair hotels they are. It's just a function and location, that makes sense.
Yeah.
That's no real surprise. But Convention and Visitor Bureau for St. Paul, for Roseville, for Greater Minneapolis.
Chamber of Commerce, probably.
They have a lot of info for lodging.
Now, are there books you can get or discount coupons for the fair?
Advance tickets are discounted, and they're available through the fair, again, at the website. And you can download them electronically, or we can send hard tickets. They're also available at Cub stores throughout the Twin Cities, actually all over Minnesota. So yeah, discount tickets are available, and we try to make it as easy as we can for people to get them.
Great. And the accessibility has been great out here. It's very clean. If you can, please try to get your COVID shot. If you cannot, put your mask on and come out anyway. One of the things that I don't like to hit on, but I suppose we should, if you should become sick all of a sudden, we do have that kind of service here too. So
there is first aid available. There are uniformed public safety officials, police officers. They're all over the fairgrounds, and they're more than happy to jump in and help.
And you have an agreement with Regents Hospital that you can get people in there if they're...
Right. And it does come up, you know, with 2 million people here, you know, we'll make a few ambulance runs during the fair, but they're available. The service here is very quick. It's far quicker than if you weren't at the fair.
That's
I had a neighbor have an issue out here, and I said, you're in the best place possible. Within 30 seconds, there was an officer. Within 90 seconds, there were EMTs, fortunately did not need a ride to the emergency room, but that's part of our public safety plan as well.
So in wrapping this whole thing up, we hope you don't get sick. We hope you get your COVID shot. Yep. We want you to come and enjoy things, and do know that the State Fair people are here to help you and make this an enjoyable time. If you need an interpreter, don't be afraid to ask. If you need wheelchair repair or need to rent a wheelchair or a scooter, it can be done here, and you can kind of make your own fun.
Yeah.
It's 12 days of fun, and it's Minnesota's happy place. And we hope you join us for the State Fair. I'm Mark Hughes for Disability Viewpoints, along with Jerry Hammer, and Steve Brunsberg, our director, and Terry, our loyal cameraman back there, the whole team at SPNN. I'm Mark Hughes. Bye for now at the State Fair. Thank you.